This is Doug DeMuro, and today I am going to tell you how I got started making YouTube videos. I made a video about this like 3+ years ago when I first started my More Doug DeMuro second channel, but I still get the question all the time, how did you get started? What was the beginning? So I decided to do a newer version of this video and kind of update it a little bit and tell you the story of how I started. Here goes. Before I get started, be sure to check out Cars and Bids, which is my enthusiast car auction website for cool cars from the modern era. Now with free listings, you can list your car for free and auction it on Cars and Bids. And we've had some great sales recently, including this 90s Ford F-250, which brought $21,500, this Ford Raptor, which sold for just over $54,000, and this 2012 Cadillac CTS V sold for just over $34,000. If you're looking to buy or sell a cool enthusiast car from the modern era, the 1980s and up, Cars and Bids is the place to do it. Check it out with daily auctions and great selection at carsandbids.com. Okay, so let's talk YouTube and how I began in the world of YouTube. I will take you back many years to when I was in college. I got a degree in economics, and everybody who went to college where I did, I went to Emory University in Atlanta, and everybody who went to college there kind of went off and got jobs in like the consulting world or the business world. That was like what everybody was really looking for, and I was too. And so I got a job working for Porsche Cars North America in Atlanta. That was where they were headquartered, and I was already there for college, so it worked out perfectly. And so I was responsible for allocating the cars to the dealerships. I worked in distribution, and I didn't choose which dealers got which cars. There was a big formula, but I was responsible for making sure that, you know, dealers had the correct number of orders to place and that sort of thing. And if dealers needed extra cars, we'd work on that and that sort of thing. And that was my job. And at the time, that wasn't as big of a job as it would be now, because Porsches are so desirable. 10 years ago, this was about 2011, it wasn't such a hot thing, but it was still, we were just recovering from the recession. Dealers were starting to get inventory again. They wanted cars again. And so it was a pretty big job, and it was a pretty important one for me. And I remember at the time I worked so hard. I was so desperate to get this job, to work for Porsche. And it was just the coolest thing in the world. And I had a Porsche company car. I had a 911. I had a series of 911s, actually. I had four of them, because with company cars, you switch out after every like 6 months to keep the miles down to sell them. And it was very special. It was a really, really cool thing. And for a kid just out of college to work for Porsche, for a car company, and to you know, have a 911, I mean, it was the coolest thing on planet Earth. But at the time I was working for Porsche, I was also doing some car freelance writing on the side. I was always good at writing. I always enjoyed writing about cars and about other stuff, frankly. And so I decided I would do some writing too. And I don't think that was allowed during my job at Porsche, but I did it anyway, because they weren't really paying all that much and I wanted to supplement my income. So I was making some money on the side writing about cars. And after maybe 3 years of working at Porsche, I guess it was, I just decided that, I was 20, 21, 22, I decided that office life, I wanted to give something else a shot. And I'm not one of these people who doesn't like office life. In fact, I actually enjoyed having coworkers, going into an office. I enjoyed all that stuff. And I still think fondly of my coworkers and talk to some of them still to this day. But I realized at that age, I wanted to try something else. And because I was already writing about cars on the side, I decided that maybe I would just give it a shot trying to be a car writer. Now, if I had known how difficult that industry is to break into, as I know now, I'm not entirely sure I would have tried it. But I had the greatest gift in the world at the time, which was ignorance. I didn't know. And that was kind of the thing that propelled me. I was like, I can do this, no problem. And so I decided at some point to quit working at Porsche in the corporate office and start writing about cars. This was a really big deal, because I had worked so hard for this job and I wanted it so much, and it was such a big deal to me having this special job. But I was young and I realized I could always go back, and it was worth a shot. It was worth taking one shot. And I'll tell you, when you're young, when you're 22 and you got no mortgage and you got no kids and you got no dog and you got no family responsibilities and no RS2, you can do stuff like this. You can take a stupid risk and kind of see what happens. So I did. So I quit the Porsche job without having really lined up much else. But I was writing at the time for Auto Trader, which was also based in Atlanta. And I was writing just sort of typical articles like, you know, should you buy your car lease when the lease is expiring? Or, you know, should you, which SUV should you buy? Which trim level should you get of the new Ford Explorer? That kind of stuff. And I was writing a bunch of those every day. I was making decent money doing it. And that was better. I was working from home. I was writing about cars. It was cool. But even then, I still wanted a little bit more. I wanted something more, you know, than just should you buy your lease, that kind of thing. So I sent an unannounced, unsolicited article to The Truth About Cars, which was, and maybe still is, I think, like a car blog that kind of had a reputation for being irreverent and silly and also not caring what anybody thought. And I sent it off to them, and the editor sent me a note back right away and said, I love this. This is fantastic. It's very funny. I'm going to publish it today. And he did. And there were like 30, 40 comments. And that was a huge deal for me. I was like, whoa, I can kind of write funnier stuff about cars, which that piece was, and kind of make fun of stuff and maybe get some traction. So for about 6 months after that, then I started sending in every week or twice a week or three times a week, I would send in a piece to The Truth About Cars and they would publish it. And before too long, my stuff started to become some of the more popular articles on The Truth About Cars. They were mostly writing about car news and industry news, but here I was like writing funny stuff. And so, you know, some people would read about Toyota stories and some people would read about Honda, but they all wanted to read, you know, Doug's kind of funny articles and they kind of started to expand. But The Truth About Cars was a really small blog and they didn't have enough money to pay me. So I was doing this for free. So at some point I said, you know what, if I'm not getting paid, I might as well try other outlets. And at the time, Jalopnik was the biggest car blog. And so I started submitting some of my funnier pieces to them as well. And they posted a couple of them and they did well. And so I would do that every week. I would say, hey guys, can you post this, please, please? They had this platform at the time that allowed like regular people to write up stories. And then if they really liked the stories, they would share them to the main front page of Jalopnik. And that was happening to me. I was getting like every week, I would write up something and then nudge them a little bit. Please, can you post this, please? And most of the time they would post it to the front page. And I remember the times where they wouldn't post it to the front page, I was so depressed for like the whole day, the whole next day. Like, oh, my story didn't get shared. Was it not good enough? Usually they were just busy. You know, they were in meetings. They didn't see me. You know? And sometimes it would get posted the next day and my mood would shoot up. And yes. But that was kind of my life. And after about six more months of doing that, Jalopnik finally started to pay me. It wasn't much. It was $25 per article. But this, it was something. It was a little bit of money. And I was more happy because I was getting recognized for like, hey, your stuff is good enough. We're actually going to bring you on. Like, you're getting paid to write for us. And obviously, I wasn't making near enough to like live on that. But I had Auto Trader that I was still working for. And I was living on that income. And I had Jalopnik that was just sort of, you know, it was a little bit. And I sort of started to phase out The Truth About Cars and I started to do more with Jalopnik. And then I would write like maybe, I don't know, I don't remember, maybe two pieces a week on Jalopnik, maybe three, maybe every day, I don't remember. But I would write a lot of stuff on Jalopnik and it was always pretty popular. It was always some of the more popular content each day. And part of the reason for that was I was very good then, and I try still to be, about interacting with the viewers. So the readers at the time, people would respond to the articles and I would get in there and try to, you know, reply to them. Hey, if they have this question about this car I just drove or this thing I just did, here's the answer straight from the source. And people liked that. And so I was doing that for, I guess, 6 months or so, getting paid. I was so excited. When a reader reached out and he said, hey, Doug, you ought to consider making videos. Have you ever thought about that? And this was 2013. And so I hadn't thought about it. It was early in the YouTube world. Like it was the frontier. And so I thought, huh, videos. Like, of course now, it's so stupid. Everybody's making videos. Not that many people are writing anymore. But at the time, this was a revolutionary concept. Videos. Huh, this guy might be onto something. So I had a Nissan Cube at the time that I had inherited from my brother, and I took that, and I took my wife, who was my girlfriend then, and I took a stepladder and a camera, and I wrote a script, and we went to the Emory University campus and tried to film a video. And that first video was so bad, it didn't end up going up, and it wasn't successful, and I didn't post it or edit it or anything. And the footage is long gone, and I don't even really think I have any photos from that day. I didn't know it would become something. You don't really know that the pivotal moments in your life are going to become something until much later. But that first video, I filmed it, didn't do anything with it, but I realized, hey, I can do this. Like, I worked with the microphones, I worked with the camera, I started to figure out how it all worked. So the next video, I had this Cadillac CTS-V station wagon that I had bought to write about for Jalopnik. And I decided to make a video saying goodbye to this car. I was selling it, it had been a year, it was time to go. And so I decided to make a video, a farewell video. And that is my first video that ever went up. And it went up in September of 2013.
I'm Doug DeMuro, and the time has come for me to sell my CTS-V wagon. But before I do, I've decided to make a little farewell video showing you what it was like to own a 550 horsepower station wagon with an automatic transmission.
The thing about it at the time was I was writing the articles, and Jalopnik was huge, so the articles were regularly getting 50, 60,000 views. So I knew the video was gonna get traffic, and so I knew it had to be good. I couldn't start off like a lot of YouTubers did. If you go back to the early days of some of the big YouTube channels, you'll see some really, you know, not well thought through content, because they were getting only 500,000 views. They didn't care, but I knew that first video would get tens of thousands of views, and I had to be good. So it was good at the time. I mean, if you watch it now, it's ridiculous. And I even did like a retrospective on this channel, like looking back at that first video. And it was terrible by modern standards, but 9 years ago, that it was fine. It was a good, decent YouTube video. So from there, I realized, hey, maybe I ought to start making videos. But it's crazy how that evolved. From throughout the entirety of 2014, I decided, you know, hey, I want to be a writer. And so the videos were a companion piece to the writing. So I would write up one of my columns that people would read, and then there'd be a little video you could watch in addition to the column if that's what you wanted to do. And that was the videos. I wasn't even looking at their view counts or my revenue, because I was so laser focused on the articles doing well. I bought a Ferrari in January of 2014 solely to write about on Jalopnik, but I also decided to make a few videos as companion pieces. And the videos started to get popular, but I was so focused on the writing that I didn't even really notice it. And I still to this day remember my 100,000 subscriber plaque came in the mail. You get one of those plaques when you hit 100,000 subscribers. And I was like, okay, who cares? Like, I'm a writer. I don't care about this video crap. And it wasn't even something I thought about. I didn't care, it wasn't on my mind. And at some point in the middle of 15, after I'd been making videos for about a year and a half, I started to realize, wait a minute, the videos are now getting more traffic because the YouTube algorithm was spreading them around and because video as a medium was becoming more popular. Videos are getting more traffic than the writing. I should really start focusing on the videos. And so from once I realized that, it was like the summer or the late fall of 15, I realized like the videos are the thing that is gonna be my thing. I still enjoyed the writing more, and I still kind of feel like I'm a better writer than I am a video person, but the videos was clearly what people wanted to see. The videos were doing better than the columns. That was where people were to consume my content, even though I myself wasn't there. I really was viewing the videos even through then as like a companion to the writing. The writing was the cool thing I was doing. The videos were like a side project. But at some point in early 2016, now we're 5.5 years ago, that started to switch. Now, once I realized this, I really started putting a lot more effort and time into videos. And famously, I bought an Aston Martin with a bumper-to-bumper warranty, and I made a big deal about how I was going to drive that car all over the country and like rack up miles and have Aston pay for everything because I had this warranty, which basically did happen. And I took that car to 34 US states, and I remember taking it to North Dakota. I've got a picture of that car in North Dakota next to a bison. Not that many Aston Vantage owners can say that. It's one of my very favorite things. But that was kind of when the videos took off. I took that car to the Bonneville Salt Flats. That video did really well. And then I sort of eased into reviewing cars. But things didn't really start to take off until about 2016, even though I had started making these videos in 13. And as I look back now, there were three major things that happened in 2016 that really blew the channel up to where it is today. So number one is I started reviewing cars. I did the Porsche Carrera GT review very famously that year. And I started, instead of just focusing on my own cars, the stuff that I had, I was going and doing different cars, which meant there was different, cool, interesting content every week, and that kept bringing people back. And that was a really big deal, it was a big decision. I also started going to 2 videos per week. In late summer of 16, I left Jalopniks to start this blog with AutoTrader called Oversteer, and with that, I switched to making 2 YouTube videos a week. And the reason for 2 a week, which I've kept ever since, was one was gonna be a car review, and the other was gonna be a piece about a car that I owned. And of course, in time, what ended up happening was the reviews were way more popular and I started just doing those exclusively. But the car reviews was a really big deal, and that switch and doing the switch to 2 videos a week was also a big step forward for my channel. The other really big thing that happened in 2016 was I did a road trip in this Aston Martin across the United States and back. I had to go on this family reunion with my wife's family, and it was in California. I was living in Pennsylvania, and I thought, well, I've got this Aston Martin with this unlimited mileage warranty. I'll drive there. And on the way back, I did stops. I did meetups. And I did one in Boise, Idaho. That was my first one. And then I did one in Billings, Montana. And then I did Minneapolis, Chicago, and Cleveland. And the Minneapolis meetup was a turning point in my entire life. And if anybody who's watching this video was there, you remember. I talk about this sometimes in my videos. It really still, like, obviously it makes me, it's kind of an emotional thing. I showed up at this meetup, and there were like, the previous meetups had been in small towns, Boise and Billings, and they were just kind of fun little gatherings, like 20 car people. But Minneapolis, a big city. And so I showed up, and there were hundreds of people there, and it was gonna rain, and they still came out with all these amazing cars. And like the Oscar Mayer Wienermobile showed up and all this stuff. And I was meeting everybody, and it was so much fun. And there were, I just never expected it would be that big. And it started raining. After like 2 hours, it started pouring, like torrential, one of the hardest rainstorms I've ever been in. And so we all had to leave, which was so sad because I would stay there all night. It was like affirmation that what I was doing was working. But I remember I called my wife on the way home, and I said, hey, like, this is real now. Like, this is my career. Like, this is what I'm doing. Because before that, it was like, this is, you know, this writing about cars thing, kind of a fun thing you can do in your 20s, not really sure if it's a real thing. But like, at that point, it was that day, that night, it was like, this is like what is, like, this is, it's this is your life now. And it was a really special moment. And then the next meetup I did was in Chicago, which was also a really big deal. There was similarly a zillion people there. We got kicked out of the location. And then the one in Cleveland was huge as well. And it was those that I really realized, like, this is a real thing. And so that was it. And that was pretty much it. Those are the beginnings. I mean, since then, it's been pretty clear to people what has happened. I started reviewing more and more cars. And over time, I kind of switched from doing cool used cars like Countachs and stuff to like more new cars, which obviously is where more views and stuff are. And that's been my genesis. And at some point, a couple years ago, I launched Cars and Bids. There's a few videos about that and how that all got started. But that's how it started. And so this is the question that I get asked the most. How did you start? And now I have this video that I can send people and explain, but that was it. That was my beginning. I really never saw myself making videos. I saw myself working in an office. That was my plan. And I was so excited to work for Porsche, and it just sort of took a different turn, and I followed that turn and kept going. And I got lucky, and here we are. It's the coolest job in the world, and I'm absolutely thrilled with it. And that's my story.